Welcome to this series on Finance 300, Managerial Finance 1. In this video, we'll have a very loosely structured discussion about what corporate finance is, some ways of structuring a business, the goal of financial management, and something called the agency problem. In other words, this is all about broad considerations that a financial manager deals with very often. So relax, there's no math in this video if that's what you were worried about. Let's say you've invented a product you're calling the Widget 9000 and you're thinking about setting up a company to manufacture and sell it, and ideally get rich doing so. But you have quite a few question marks in your business plan. For example, you've saved up $100,000 over a few years by working a 9-to-5, but it isn't nearly enough. Just based on your preliminary calculations of what you'll need to set up your business, you need to get double that, and working another decade is not an option. But how? After a bit of research, you narrow it down to two options. Option A, the bank is willing to offer a $100,000 loan with 10% annually compounding interest. Option B, an investor is interested in offering you the same amount for 40% equity in the company. Do you go with A or B, or some combination of both? That kind of question, or really any question that asks about how much and what mix of debt or equity your company uses, is a question about capital structure. It gets a bit more complicated than that, and we'll explore those issues in detail in later videos so we can find objective numerical answers as to what's best for our business. Now, once you have that money, what do you put it into? Well, obviously you'll need some industrial machines to make the Widget 9000. Obviously. There are two competing alternatives. The $15,000 Widget Maker Plus, which lasts for 5 years, and the $10,000 Widget Assembler 2015 edition, which lasts for 3 years. Which one you pick depends on which one is likelier to make you more money over its lifetime. That sort of question is a question about capital budgeting. That is to say, capital budgeting is about anything regarding the management of a firm's long-term investments, such as what machinery to buy, whether to buy or lease, and other similar decisions that we'll consider later. But we have more than just long-term investments. We need to think about the short term too. In other words, how will we manage our money in our day-to-day operations? How much cash should we have on hand? Do we sell the Widget 9000 on credit to customers? What credit terms do we offer if we do? Should we buy from our suppliers on credit? This is all about working capital management. Working capital being the difference between short-term assets and short-term liabilities, which we'll talk about later. These questions are some of the first we'll tackle, to some extent, in the coming videos. When you study corporate finance, you're essentially studying capital structure, capital budgeting, and working capital management. The financial manager is someone who makes decisions regarding these facets of business. Another consideration is how you want to structure your business. Technically, you could just start buying equipment, making your product, and selling it all by yourself, and that'd be what's called a sole proprietorship, one of the simplest business structures in Canada. It's great because it's the most hassle-free form of business to start up, it's not as heavily regulated as other business structures, and you get to keep all the profits for yourself. But there's a catch. You've got unlimited personal liability for any business debts or obligations because there's no legal separation between you and your business. For example, if a defective Widget 9000 winds up injuring a customer, the customer has to sue you, and if they win, the money comes out of your bank account. Also, it's tough to get people to give you money personally, unless you've got a stellar track record as a famous inventor and entrepreneur. Even with a really good business plan and product, your chances of making it big are slim. And if you've got dreams of setting up a business empire, you can't exactly do that as a sole proprietor either, because a sole proprietorship ends in one of two ways. You either stop doing business, or you stop living. Similar to this is a partnership. It can be better than a sole proprietorship because you can access more capital, tap into your partner's expertise, as well as split liability amongst yourselves. But the downside is that you still have unlimited personal liability, even for something your partner may have done without your awareness or approval. The final business structure we'll talk about is the corporation, which is a separate legal entity from you, the founder. Therefore, unlike a sole proprietorship and partnership, a corporation can last beyond your lifetime, ownership can be transferred, and you're shielded from unlimited personal liability. A defective Widget 9000 injured a customer, they can go ahead and sue your newly formed Widget Inc., but not you. Moreover, corporations are seen as more reliable investment opportunities than sole proprietors or partnerships, and have more ways to raise money as well as an easier time doing it. But you only get all these advantages if you go through a long, expensive registration process, and at the end of it, you get taxed doubly, once at the corporate level and again at the personal level. Corporations are the most common form of business in Canada, and for this reason, we'll move forward as if Widget Inc. and every other company we talk about is incorporated. Often you'll hear people say that the main focus of financial managers is to maximize profits, and while that's certainly an indication of effective management, it's not the most nuanced answer. Whether management is successful or not in that regard depends on what we're measuring as profit. Is it yearly profit? Is it long-term profit? How long is long-term? What then should our standard of success be? The answer is simple if we step into the shoes of the owners of our corporation, Widget Inc., who are, for all intents and purposes, the shareholders. From their perspective, the matter is simple. A good financial decision is anything that increases the value of their shares, and a bad decision is anything that reduces it. No ambiguity and no questions of short or long term. So, refining what we said earlier, when you're studying corporate finance, you're learning to identify which capital structure, capital budgeting, and working capital management decisions will move you toward a higher stock price. Keeping all this in mind, you steer Widget Inc. towards growth and prosperity, and you do such a good job that it's now viable for you to expand your operations. The problem is that once you do, it'll no longer be humanly possible for you to manage everything. You'll need others to make decisions on behalf of your corporation, some of which will undoubtedly impact the price of your stock. These decision makers are called agents of the corporation. There's a small chance their decisions could launch Widget Inc. into the Fortune 500 or make it go up in flames, but there's probably a higher chance it'll be something less dramatic in between those two extremes. Let's talk about the risk of bad decisions. Sometimes they happen due to incompetence, and at other times they're just bad luck. But sometimes, agents might purposely make bad decisions. Now you, as the founder of Widget Inc., might be wondering why these people on your payroll are purposely hurting your stock price. It's likely because they're experiencing a conflict of interest, or in other words, their interests have diverged from that of the corporation's. This is what's called the agency problem. Say, for example, that management devotes its efforts to fighting off a takeover bid because they're afraid they'll lose their jobs if new owners come in. This would save management jobs at the expense of the shareholder, as share prices would likely decline in this process. This is an indirect cost, a lost opportunity or suboptimal decision taken by management which reduces the share price of the company. And if there are indirect costs, they must be contrasted with direct costs, which include expenditure that benefits management at the expense of the shareholders, like buying fancy corporate jets, and the costs to monitor management by using, say, external auditors. The best way to combat this conflict of interest is to consider whether or not management is being compensated to make good decisions on behalf of the company. Are there pay bonuses, promotions, and recognition given to managers for meeting performance metrics? If not, are shareholders exercising their power to vote and putting pressure on the board of directors to get rid of problematic managers? At any rate, these questions of corporate governance are for a later date. For now, it's enough to identify and understand what's meant by the agency problem. That brings us to the end of the video. Still confused? Rewind to the relevant part of the video by clicking on the sections listed to the left. For more, be sure to take a look at the tip sheets uploaded to the Academic Success Center website by following the link in the description. Need a more face-to-face approach? Check out tutoring hours at the Ryerson University Academic Success Center's website.